Reporter, today is January 27th, 1865, in the House of Representatives. We are continuing the debate on SJ-16, which proposes a 13th Amendment to our Constitution. The proposed amendment states, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime, whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States or any place subject to their jurisdiction. 7 months ago, the proposed amendment was defeated in the House of Representatives when it failed to obtain the necessary two-thirds vote for passage. Today, we continue the discussion with the representative from the South proposing an economic argument in favor of slavery. The speaker recognizes the gentleman from West Virginia.
You must know that Southerners are dependent on slaves. The South's main export is cotton. If we didn't have slaves, we'd have no one to pick the cotton. We supply two-thirds of the world's cotton. If we didn't have slaves, there would not be enough cotton available on the world market, and everyone would lose money. In addition, slaves do the work of harvesting tobacco, working dairy farms, weaving, building railroads, carpentry, washing clothes, cooking, and butchering. Without slaves, there would not be enough people to do these jobs, nor enough money to pay them. If we let them go free, the entire economy will collapse.
How will the economy collapse?
What's wrong with them? That argument about the sudden economy collapsing? Please, that's crazy. It's just an old worry.
Gentleman from Pennsylvania, may return the argument.
Thaddeus Stevens, Mr. Speaker. People are more important than money. You see, slaves are totally different than a person.
You know very well the Supreme Court said that slaves are not people.
I agree. That's a Dred Scott case. Held that those of the African race, whether free or slave, can never become citizens within the meaning of the Constitution.
You Northerners need slavery. You better. If you let them go free, profit.
The gentleman from Kentucky will keep decorum.
My apologies, Mr. Speaker. My zeal got the better of me.
This is a very important debate. I will allow free discussion if you are all able to keep some decorum.
Without slaves, farms would have to pay people to do the jobs that slaves are doing now. Farm owners may not even have the money to pay enough people to work. Then they would have to charge more for their products, and then no one could afford them.
Without slaves, the economy would collapse. The economy would improve. More people's money means more consumers to buy goods.
I believe that prices will increase, but not cause inflation.
The gentleman from Ohio is now recognized.
Slavery is morally wrong and unfair. Abolitionists in this country have been going against slavery since Jefferson was president. It puts people into endless work with no pay and little food.
I agree. You give your slaves very little food and barely enough water to survive.
Well, I should beg to differ. I have slaves myself, and I do believe I treat them rather well. My slaves include mostly men and women, and what child slaves I do have, why, their only job is to play with my children. My slaves do not do strenuous work. They simply work my cotton gins. They are given gloves to protect their hands, and I whip not a one of them. They live in the very same manner, the very same house as I do. My slaves are content.
That may or may not be true, but not all masters are that way. Many whip their slaves, make them do backbreaking work, and force them to live in poor conditions. Also, when you sell slaves, you tear them from their families.
That's true. You can't just take children away from their families. Any argument to the contrary is ignorant and outrageous.
Slaves can buy freedom for themselves as well as their family members.
Much of the time they can't. Many slave children never know their own parents.
Whipped, not paid, families torn apart, that's just cruel.
I was born into slavery. At the time, my mother and father were with the same slave owner. When I was 5, my master decided to sell my father, so he was then shipped to the market and sold for $85. When I ran away with my mother and newly born sister, we reunited with him in Ohio. He'd also escaped. My parents and sister both died after a couple months. It is very harsh when your family gets taken away from you. My friend's parents were taken away from her, and they never got reunited again.
That's very sad. You know, a lot of Miss Women are abolitionists. Susan B. Anthony is an abolitionist as well as a suffragette. Lucretia Mott speaks publicly out against slavery. I wish I had so much courage. Someone even write books, such as Uncle Tom's Cabin, written by Harriet Beecher Stowe.
Yes, I also know some famous African-American women. Sarah Parker Beeman was college-educated and traveled to England to speak out against slavery. And Maria W. Stewart started her career as a domestic servant, but then became the first American woman to lecture mixed audiences.
Slavery makes our nation look bad. Other countries cannot say it's a strong men when we keep slaves.
Slaves don't make us look bad, they make us look kind. When we find our slaves, they're hungry, often wounded, and hiding in the woods. We nurse them back to health.
They're not anymore hungry. They're at your plantation. No, they're not. Factory workers have homes. They're not anymore hungry. They're at your plantation. No, they're not. Factory workers have homes.
I once worked in a factory. They were long, hard hours. I was not allowed to leave for lunch, supper. Some days I was not allowed to leave at all. They were hard. They were long, hard hours. Very hard work. And I was paid very little, perhaps 10 cents a day. I finally managed to get this job. Thank goodness.
Factory workers work in smoke, maybe even toxic fumes. Our slaves work outside with lovely fresh air.
How would you like it? If you're forced to work all day, with little food and no pay, certainly some masters are less cruel than others, but it is the institution of slavery that is the reason for this bloody civil war.
If slavery is abolished, then this war will end. Slavery must not survive.
Lincoln did not intentionally start the Civil War. He was sending supplies to Fort Sumter when gunfire rang out.
Lincoln did not create the Civil War. He tried to prevent it. He wanted slavery to die a natural death, but the Kansas Nebraska Act stopped it. It allowed states to individually decide if they wanted slavery or not.
Tensions were too high between the slave-owning states and free states. War became inevitable.
Our slaves are safer as slaves. They couldn't find food or even housing if they were freed.
If we freed our slaves, they'd never get an education. We're not responsible for the actions of a few bad masters. We educate some of our slaves.
Southerners can't keep up with their slaves. I, myself, have often defended fugitive slaves in court without charge. You have only recently discovered the Underground Railroad. Thanks to courageous people like Harriet Tubman, over 100,000 slaves have already escaped.
Underground Railroad, pah. I'm a conductor. I don't free slaves I recognize, of course, for all the masters I know treat their slaves well. I free slaves only if they look physically or perhaps mentally beaten.
Slaves are nothing but property. They are valuable assets to be free from federal interference. The Dred Scott case proved that point. Are you being the United States Supreme Court?
The Declaration of Independence. States and all men are created equal. Are you denying our forefathers?
If slaves were freed, they could steal jobs from people like us. Are you prepared to give up your job to a freed slave?
People of the African descent can't even run for office enough. How can they remove us from office?
Stealing jobs? Quite frankly, I don't believe that. True, they are secretly learning how to read and write behind the master's backs, but I doubt they steal jobs from working white people.
Most slaves educate themselves behind their master's back. They learn how to read and write from books, and they often have to teach themselves how to write their own name.
If the 13th Amendment doesn't pass now, the next president might be in favor of slavery. All this arguing would have been for nothing.
It is very clear from the enthusiastic discussion that the 13th Amendment would change the lives of many Americans, both free and slave. But we do not have time to continue this discussion today. We will reconvene tomorrow. The House stands adjourned.
On January 31st, 1865, the House passed the amendment.
The Speaker even voted to make sure the amendment would pass.
The total votes were 119 yeas, 56 nays, and 8 abstentions.
The next day, the 13th Amendment went to President Lincoln, and his home state of Illinois was the first to ratify it.
On December 18, 1865, the Secretary of State verified ratification. Although the state of Mississippi wouldn't ratify the 13th Amendment until 1995.
Following ratification, the lives of former slaves were only slightly less painful. They still had poor working and living conditions, were paid a minimum wage, and could not vote.
Although more progress was needed, the 13th Amendment officially ended the institution of slavery in the United States of America.
My name is Evan, I played a representative from Ohio.
My name is Anna, I played a representative from Kentucky in the U.S. House of Representatives.
My name is Andre, I played an abolitionist from Pennsylvania, 32.
My name is Josh, I played a representative from West Virginia.
My name is Alexis, and I played a former slave.
My name is Maggie, and I played the friend of the former slave.
My name is Willow, and I played the Speaker of the House, whose name at the time was Schuyler Colfax.
Instantly, flags were raised at half-mast all over the city. The bells tolled solemnly, and with incredible swiftness, Washington went into deep, universal mourning. Nature seemed to sympathize in the general lamentation, and tears of rain fell from the moist and somber sky. Noah Brooks, journalist.
Hello, my name is Noah Brooks. I'm a reporter for the Sacramento Daily Journal. May I ask you some questions?
Hello, yes you may. My name is General John B.S. Todd.
General Todd, I can see you're attending the funeral for the president. How have the lines been to wait to pay your respects?
Well, my cousin is Mary Todd Lincoln. Yes, there are a lot of people here, and lines to pay respects have been long. Some people have even been sleeping in the parks to get a chance to see Mr. Lincoln.
How has the family been doing?
Well, I'm sorry to say, Mrs. Lincoln isn't doing so well. She's so overwhelmed that she has stayed upstairs in the White House. I doubt we will be seeing her at any of these funerals to be held on the way to Springfield. Robert will be the first one on the train. He will only stay a little while, and then he will get off and travel ahead to Springfield.
Good to know. Well, that's too bad about Mrs. Lincoln. The family must be devastated.
Yes, they were so happy. But then after losing Eddie, then Willie, and now Mr. Lincoln, life has been rough for them.
I know, and it could get worse with the rumors to steal the president's body once they bury him.
Yes, I've heard about that. People will do anything for money. I'm surprised they didn't kidnap him before for a ransom. I think that was John Wilkes Booth's original plan.
People have no respect. Have you heard about the killing of John Wilkes Booth?
Yes, I've heard a man named Boston Corbett shot him in his head.
Yes, that is true. Well, thank you for the information, Mr. Duke. Well, thank you for the information. I'm sorry for your family's loss and the loss we all feel. Good day. Let me see. This is what I'll post. I had an interview today with General John B.S. Todd. He told me that Mrs. Lincoln will probably not be attending any of the funerals to to be held on the way to Springfield. He also told me that there are rumors to steal the president's body for money. We know that Boston Corbett received $1,000 after he shot John Wilkes Booth in the head after trapping him in a tobacco barn.
Streetcars in Indianapolis wore slogans of mourning. Sorrow for the dead, justice for the living, punishment for traitors, the carnage. Fear not, Abraham, I am thy shield, thy reward shall be exceedingly great, carnage. Thou art gone, and friend and foe alike appreciate thee now. Car number 20.
Oh, excuse me. So aren't you the conductor of this train?
Yes. My name is J.D. Dukehart.
My name's Noah Brooks. I report for the paper. May I ask you some questions?
Yes, of course.
You are conducting this train for the sad but historic trip to take Mr. Lincoln's body back to Springfield. How fast has this train been moving?
This train has been moving at 20 miles per hour all the way to Springfield. We have carried 300 people, mostly dignitaries and soldiers, changing at every stop. And we are in Michigan City right now.
How many more stops do we have?
I reckon we have 39 more stops. This is our 405th stop. Altogether, we will have traveled through 444 stops following Mr. Lincoln's second inaugural train route. We did skip Pittsburgh, also Cincinnati, because of all the Southern sympathizers and Democrats. Some Southerners have even thrown rocks at the train. See?
How disrespectful.
I couldn't believe my eyes. But mostly, all along the journey, people have had their heads uncovered, even the men, as a sign of deep respect for the president. Lots of ladies wearing white. And all along the 1,666-mile train route, people have chanted, "The Lincoln train is coming! The Lincoln train is coming!" The funeral in Philadelphia was magnificent.
Can you tell me anything about the presidential train car?
There is a lot to tell. It was constructed in 1864 in Alexandria, Virginia, with three rooms for work and sitting, but frankly was not designed for long-term travel. It was called the United States. It was to serve as the president's special train car. Unfortunately, he never got to use it while he was alive.
Well, thank you for your time, Mr. Dukehart. Have a good night.
You're welcome.
Mr. Dukehart! Mr. Dukehart!
Oh, excuse me.
I just missed the train conductor, and I need to speak with him.
Ah, yes. I just was speaking to him. Why do you need to see him?
My husband, the funeral director, and my cousin, the embalmer, need some information from him.
Before you speak with him, can I talk to you for a couple of minutes? My name's Noah Brooks. I report for the paper.
Sure, I think I have time.
The country is stricken with grief and are all grateful for news about the president. Since you are related to the funeral director and the embalmer, Can you tell me about how they are caring for the president on this long trip to Springfield and all the funerals along the way?
They're using a special process on Mr. Lincoln's body. They shaved his beard except for a small tuft on his chin. The embalming process followed directly after the autopsy. Before embalming began, they arched his eyebrows, closed his eyes, and curved his mouth into a smile. They injected a special embalming fluid through the femoral artery, a process originally developed by the French and adopted by Brown and Alexander before the Civil War began. They've used cosmetics to touch up the bruises around the eyes from the natures of murder and the impact of that one deadly bullet. I'm so glad Mr. Lincoln has such a beautiful coffin. It's special, you know, extra long, made of walnut, with rich black drapings and silver handles, decorated with leaves and shamrocks. Anything else you'd like to know?
Can you tell me what you are doing for your husband?
I'm just running an errand for him. Not that he can really trust me to do that, seeing as I'm so chatty. I've learned we need to delay departure from this city because some important men from Chicago were supposed to arrive and ride the train to welcome it into their city, but they'll be arriving late, so we wait here a little longer.
Well, then I must let you get on your way.
Thank you. Ah, Mr. Ducat, Charles sent me on a mission to find you. I've learned we need to have a funeral within minutes.
Well, go tell Charles to get Mr. Lincoln's body ready. I'll direct people to get a funeral platform for the funeral. I suppose we could put a funeral together. There's no telling how long it'll be before we head into Chicago.
Thank you. Now I must be getting back before Mr. Brown starts looking for me. Good day.
Yes, good day.
You're very welcome. I'm Johnny Smith, ma'am.
I'm Cheryl O'Reilly. Do you want to walk and talk?
Sure. This is such a sad affair, ma'am. My good friend Henry Rathbone was with Lincoln at Ford's Theater when he was assassinated. Now I blame yourself for Lincoln's death.
Yes, I've heard of this here Henry Rathbone. I've also heard that Lincoln haunts the White House, the state capitol, and walks the streets of downtown Springfield.
I do not mean to be rude, ma'am, but do you really believe in all this malarkey?
Absolutely. They say that there's an owl on the windowsill, and owls are a sign of death.
Sure.
Thank you for fighting for my freedom, young man.
You're very welcome.
What's you drawing over there?
I'm fixing to draw Mr. Lincoln's funeral chain when it comes.
The train is coming.
I may have to go stand my guard. Nice meeting you two.
That's a magnificent sketch.
Why, thank you. I'm Terry McKee.
Ma'am, I'm Slade Williams, a reporter. May I ask you some questions?
Mm-hmm.
I see you have high regards for Mr. Lincoln. I see you have high regards for Mr. Lincoln. Do you believe they abolished the 13th Amendment abolishing slavery?
I honestly thought that there are no chances of passing.
Where are you from?
Nashville, Tennessee.
What was it like being a slave in Nashville?
Well, it was mostly living a life of fear. I was under constant worry that I would get whipped. But then, Master sold me to a man named Thomas Clark who didn't believe in slavery, so I was sold into freedom.
How do you feel about the president's death?
It was very devastating to me and my kin.
Why?
Because Lincoln was our only hope of abolishing slavery. But then, when he died, we were afraid that everything accomplished in the war would be lost, including our freedom.
I'm so sorry to hear that. We'll have to see how President Lincoln's assassination will affect our whole country.
It's too bad we won't get to see what Mr. Lincoln would have done next.
But I'll try to remember him as I can with this here sketch.
Well, good day.
Oh, good day.
Good morrow.
Kind sir.
Lincoln's law partner, William H. Herndon, wrote, "All day long and through the night, a stream of people filed reverently by the catwalk. Some of them were his colleagues at the bar, some his old friends from New Salem, some crippled soldiers fresh from the battlefields of the war, and some were little children who, scarce realizing the impressiveness of the scene, were destined to live and tell their children yet to be born the sad story of Abraham Lincoln's death."
I'm Slade Williams, a reporter for the State Register. May I ask you some questions?
Yes.
Aren't you Mr. Herndon?
Yes, I'm William Herndon, Abraham Lincoln's third law partner. I wanted to pay my respects. I was very close to the president.
How are you dealing with this cruel assassination of your friend and our president?
I'm in shock. At least he'll come to rest here in his beloved Springfield at Oak Ridge Cemetery.
That reminds me, did you hear that Mrs. Lincoln wouldn't release the president's body until it was agreed that he would be buried here in Springfield?
Yes. Yes, and he would want to be buried here too. It's so sad that Mrs. Lincoln was so distraught that she didn't come to any of the funerals and won't be here for the one even in Springfield. Well, I'm moving up in line to pay my respects. Are you in line to do so?
Maybe I will. It'll give me a chance to get a closer look at Mr. Lincoln.
Well, you may go before me.
No, sir, I will go to the end of the line. I hope to speak with you after the funeral. Will that be all right with you?
Yes. Well, good day.
"20 Days of Funerals to Honor President Lincoln." Here in Springfield, Bishop Simpson ended his eulogy by saying, "Chieftain, farewell. The nation mourns thee. Mothers shall teach thy name to their lisping children.
The youth of our lands shall emulate thy virtues. Statesmen shall study thy records and learn lessons of wisdom. Mute though thy lips be, yet they still speak.
Hushed is thy voice, but its echoes of liberty are ringing through the world, and the sons of bondage listen with joy.
Prison thou art in death, yet thou art marching abroad, and chains and manacles are bursting at thy touch. Thou didst fall not for thyself.
The assassin had no hate for thee. Our hearts were aimed at, our national life was sought.
We crown thee as our martyr, and humanity enthrones thee as her triumphant son.
Hero, martyr, friend, farewell.
My name is Ruby, and I play the train conductor, J.D. Dukart.
My name is Izzy, and I played the part of Tara McKee, the freed slave artist.
My name's Katie. I played Noah Brooks, a reporter, and William Herndon, Abraham Lincoln's third law partner.
I'm Andy, and I played the part of Cheryl O'Reilly, the crazy old lady.
My name is Elise, and I played the chatty Elizabeth Brown.
My name's Alonzo, and I play Johnny Smith, a Union soldier.
My name is Quincy, and I played General John B.S. Todd and the reporter Slade Williams.
Thank you.
next door. I and some other neighbors of Lincoln are waiting to view the body of our late president, Abraham Lincoln. We have chosen the name Bittersweet Times because our great president, Mr. Lincoln, has just been assassinated. But the Union just won the Civil War and all slaves are freed. I hope you will enjoy our presentation of Bittersweet Times. For 17 years, Mr. Lincoln and his family lived with some of us in our diverse neighborhood here in Springfield. Here is one of his closest neighbors.
Good morning. I am Charles E. Arnold, Sangamon County Sheriff. I am on duty today to help control a crowd that is estimated to be 75,000 people, all wanting to view the body of our beloved president. But I have not come just to control the crowds. I need to also pay my respects to one of my dearest friends. We saw each other almost every day when he and his family lived here.
Oh, I remember you. I sold my house to him in 1847.
The Reverend Francis Springer, right?
Yes. Before you bought my house for $800, I ran a private school and pastored an evangelical Lutheran congregation in my home. Is it still standing across Jackson Street from the Lincoln home?
Indeed it is. My wife and I raised 5 children there. Do you remember that I was a carpenter, a miller, and county treasurer before I became sheriff?
Yes, I remember.
Please excuse me. I need to check on the crowd. Some of them have been waiting hours to go upstairs and are getting anxious and a bit unruly.
Before I left Springfield, I became superintendent of schools. The Lincolns supported me in wanting good education for our children. I left Springfield to become president of a seminary in a neighboring county. I later enlisted in the Union Army, and at Fort Smith, I was post chaplain.
Welcome back to Springfield, Reverend Springer. I am Jameson Jenkins. I remember you were a strong advocate for freeing the slaves. I'm not surprised you joined the Union Army. I was a drayman.
What's a drayman?
A drayman, Julia, is a person who drives a dray, or a flat-bottom carriage used to pull goods and occasionally some people. It's usually pulled by horses or mules. Friends meet Julia Spray.
Hello, my parents were German immigrants. When my father died, my mother bought a house on the west side of A Street, 2 doors down from the Lincolns. I babysat the Lincoln boys, Willie and Tad, and was devastated when Willie died. I've never been so sad.
Hello, I am Hannah Shearer, and I'm a very close confidant of Mary Lincoln. She was traumatized at Willie's death. She was so upset she didn't even attend the funeral. From her letters, she said, Willie was the idolized child of the household, and I cannot believe what happened to poor Mr. Lincoln.
Well, it was hard for us, too. Mr. Lincoln was one of my best friends. He was the one that convinced me to vote to move the Illinois capital from Vandalia to Springfield. We served together as state representatives upstairs in the Hall of Representatives for the first session in this building. We got paid $2 a day for our work.
I helped build the state capitol. I'm a bricklayer by trade. Thanks for giving me some extra work. Oh, hello. My name is Jared Irwin. I helped build the Lincoln House on the corner of 8th and Jackson. I also live next to Sheriff Arnold. When I saw the Lincolns preparing to leave for Washington City, I saw Miss Lincoln burning some papers and asked her if I can have some, and later wrote a diary off what I read from those papers.
I remember that day, Mr. Irwin. That was a sad day for me. I'd grown to love the Lincoln family.
Hello, I am Maria Vance. I was a housekeeper in the Lincoln home for 10 years. I was a cook, laundress, and maid 4 to 5 days a week. I closed up the house for them when they left for Washington City.
Well, I think I calmed them all down. My, the crowd keeps growing. The line stretches as far north and south, east and west as the eye can see. I am afraid not everyone is going to get to view Mr. Lincoln's body.
Before we go upstairs to pay our respects to our dear friend, Mr. Lincoln, let's gather around and recall some happy memories.
I would like to go first. I love the whole Lincoln family. They called me Aunt Maria. Mary was quick-tempered, lively, and a very loving mother and wife. Mr. Lincoln was always reading when he was not working or sleeping. He was very respectful to colored people and very fond of children. Robert was always kind to me and came to visit me when I was in Danville and he was in Washington City. I made the Lincoln family favorite corn pone and bacon.
I remember eating that when I went to babysit the Lincoln boys. I think I mentioned that in the diary I wrote. This is
I cannot wait until John McSpooth is captured and punished. Why did he have to do what he did?
Booth was upset because Lincoln freed the slaves.
The 13th Amendment, one of Lincoln's greatest accomplishments.
I have to say that my favorite Lincoln quote is about slavery. No man is good enough to govern another man without that man's consent.
I like another Lincoln quote. My concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side, for God is always right.
Abraham also quoted from the Declaration of Independence, "All men are created equal." He believed, as do I, that all of humanity is created equal, including whites, colored, men, women, and young people.
I took action on slavery by being involved in the Underground Railroad.
What was the Underground Railroad?
It was a network of secret rats and houses designed to help slaves escape from the south to the north, some went as far as Canada. It was believed that I had tunnels connecting to my house, and I'll not confirm or deny that.
I helped with the escape of some slaves. I helped over 300 orphans find homes. We are indebted to Mr. Lincoln for his stand. He was an inspiration to us all.
One January night, I led a dozen slaves north to Champaign. This was known as the Slave Stampede. Many of the slaves were captured, but a few escaped. Because of this, many people believed I turned on the slaves and turned them in, but I did not. Lincoln and I both hated slavery, and we both took action in eliminating it.
There, Mr. Lincoln. Upstairs, Mr. During Mr. Lincoln's House Divided speech upstairs, he said, "A house divided against itself cannot stand. I believe this government cannot endure permanently half slave, half free."
The night before Mr. Lincoln gave his famous House Divided speech, he read it to a few of us around that table. We had no idea it would become so famous.
Don't forget Mr. Lincoln supported our temperance movement.
What is the temperance movement?
Temperance means moderation, and that's our goal, to moderate people's way of drinking alcohol. You see, drinking makes people abusive to others, including their family. Remember, Charles, you, Mr. Lincoln, and I sometimes met at temperance meetings to discuss our matters.
Mr. Lincoln did not drink alcoholic beverages and never shared strong drinks in his home. People can be strange sometimes. I'm lucky my husband never abused me.
As I said earlier, I was one of Mary's closest friends. After I moved to Pennsylvania, we continued to write letters to each other. Dear Mary, she would often be worried because of her responsibilities, and Lincoln too. When I lived in the neighborhood, Mary would tell me about her life. She was raised in a mansion with slaves, but she always supported Mr. Lincoln and his beliefs. I named one of my children William Lincoln Cheer, and it pleased Mary so much. Did you hear about the time the Lincoln boys tried to create a waterfall by pouring water down the stairs? Yeah, they were fun to play with, especially when they attacked. They were so carefree. My mother and I went to babysit them. My mother would scold them for being too mischievous. I have to say, the parents pampered and spoiled them. After Willie's death, I understand Mary neglected Tad a little.
I can see how you were attracted to the boys, but I liked Robert more than Willie and Tad. He was so quiet and calm. As I've already said, he was quite kind to me. Not too many men back then were kind to women, especially Clover.
My brother, Lewis W. Minor, was also a close friend and neighbor of the Lincolns. He is going to read from a scripture from John 14 in the Bible tomorrow at the funeral of Oak Ridge Cemetery. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me."
Those are the words of Jesus. They will help us all in our grief.
Yes, this is a bittersweet time.
Y'all remember I drove Mr. Lincoln to the railroad station the day he left us? During his farewell speech, he acknowledged God as his guide. "Without the assistance of the divine being, I cannot succeed. With that same assistance, I cannot fail."
I remember these words: "Go with him who can come with me, remain with you, and be everywhere for good. Let us confidently hope all yet will be well."
This farewell message will be an ongoing memory for us and for many generations to come. As Secretary of War stated to the small gathering people next to Lincoln's bedside the day he died,
"Now he belongs to the ages."
This concludes our presentation. Thank you for allowing us to share what we have learned.
Washington, D.C.
Do you know Lincoln from his days here in Springfield?
I know Lincoln, but he's no friend of mine. He's a yellow-bellied, lily-livered, cotton-picking son of a gun. He can go to heck, that no-good traitor.
Sir, I'll ask you not to speak ill of our president.
Your president, not mine. He's ripped his country apart the same as many of us patriots want to see him bawling for it.
I, too, am a patriot, as well as supporter of Lincoln. I am also in the Republican Party and was appointed to this position by Morris Lindsay in 1861, after Lincoln took office. I'll weigh your mail and send it, but I insist you bite your tongue in my presence.
Next time, I'll just send a telegram.
Pirate!
Susie, stop dancing. You're embarrassing me.
I'm very sorry, Mother. It's just that I'm so excited. We might get a letter from Father today.
Indeed, one from the courthouse and one.
Wonderful. You know, normally I wouldn't come in on a Sunday, but I just couldn't wait. Can I pay for it now?
Of course. That'll be 12 cents, please.
Really? Do you think the price will ever go down? It just seems to keep going up and up.
I wish I could tell you, ma'am, but I can't predict the future. Here's your letter.
Here you are, sir. 12 cents.
What does it say, Mother? What does it say?
Dear Sarah, I received your letter on Wednesday morning and was very happy to hear from you. When I am away from home, nothing has such a tendency to make me cheerful, to elevate my spirits, as a letter from you. The holding of court would be an agreeable occupation to my mind, really pleasant to me if that when I got out of court, I could have the chance to occasionally kiss you. I am uneasy without you. Your hold on my affection, dear Sarah, grows stronger every day. I feel as if you were a part of myself, and that without you, that I could not enjoy my life. Your affectionate husband, David Wells. Oh, I do love hearing from him.
Now the next letter. It's from the battlefield. James wrote back. I hope he's okay.
I'm sure he's fine. Dear Susan. Silly James, he forgot he couldn't read. It is very hard here in the cold climate of the battlefield. I am in need of many things, like food, water, and something like cloth. I am very sorry that I have to go, but I will miss you more and more every day. Love, James. He is in need of many things. Good thing we made him this care package.
Yes, we packed him a lot of things, like cloth, apples, soap, socks, slippers, and a canteen for the battlefield.
Hello, I have two letters for you today. It looks like this one is from your brother, from the battlefield.
I'll take the one from my brother, but I don't want the other one.
20 cents.
Mother, why did that boy want another letter?
I don't know. Pardon me, young man, but I will pay for your other letter if you like.
Thanks for the offer, ma'am, but it's not that important. I don't need to read it.
Mother, how did he know it wasn't important?
I don't know.
I don't mean to interrupt, but I overheard your question. They make a mark on the back of the paper. A circle means it's important and the recipient should pay for it immediately. And a dash means that it can wait. It's a very common practice of those of modest means.
It's very clever.
Maybe, but you wonder why the price of your mail keeps going up and up. This is one of the many reasons. If we started charging the sender instead of the recipient, we wouldn't have this problem. If they want to keep saving money, they can just keep cross-writing.
What's cross-writing?
Cross-writing is where they fill up the page one way, turn it sideways, and fill it up again.
Here's an example.
It's very difficult to read. Thank you for your time, Mr. Postmaster, but we must be going now. Come along, Susan.
Good day.
Hello, Mr. Spooner. Your reputation precedes you. Have you come here to brag about the American Letter Mail Company?
Brag? Maybe in the opinions of others.
Then why are you here?
I'm just here to introduce myself.
It's a pleasure to meet you, but I'm very busy today.
Then I'll make this quick. Since I was a slave, but I managed to escape servitude, since we, the slaves, couldn't communicate by conventional means, we used song, dance, bird calls, and quilt codes.
What are quilt codes?
Quilt codes are secret symbols sewn into quilts. The first symbol is the goose. Slaves follow geese because they lead them to food, water, and shelter. The second symbol is a monkey wrench. The monkey wrench shows what you need to survive mentally, physically, and spiritually. The third symbol is the sailboat. The sailboat represents that water is nearby and a boat is there or on their way to pick you up. The last symbol, and probably the most important, is the wagon wheel. The wagon wheel shows what tools you need to survive because most places keep with only their wheelbarrow.
So again, why are you here?
I'm here to tell you I have created a 3-cent stamp. Since I own and started the American Letter Mail Company, it is offered in nearly all cities in the free states. Messengers travel on steamboat and train to deliver mail from point A to point B. You know that I'm in competition with the U.S. Post Office.
So have you come here to brag about how your 3-cent stamp is 1/4 price of my 12-cent stamp? With an 84-year-old former slave is communing directly with the United States Post Office.
I did not come to brag. My livelihood is being extinguished. I have fewer workers now and will soon have to close up shop. I do not have the resources to challenge their constitutionality. I have recently wrote a pamphlet called The Unconstitutionality of the Laws of Congress Prohibiting Private Mail. It explains everything.
I'm very sorry for you, but I believe this is a positive step for the United States, not to mention job security for me.
Young kids, they don't understand anything. How did he get this job?
Thanks, Mom, and I still don't get used to working on this.
Willie, that's blarney. Your father had him once and he got used to him one day. He said it was a wee bit uncomfy, but still blarney.
And Mom, I want a job.
I know, Willie. We'll just have to keep on looking. Excuse me.
Hey, aren't you Willie O'Malley, the Irish boy from the railroad? They say you got banged up pretty good, and Molly, his mother.
Aye, we are. You know that old saying, there's an Irishman under every tie? Well, it's true. Willie here got stuck in one and had to yank out in fear of a train coming.
Ouch, that must have hurt. You're lucky to be alive.
It did hurt a lot, and I'm also looking for a job, and oh, so many worries. I just hope they're okay back home.
So what can I do for you?
We are wanting to send a letter back to Ireland, and I reckon we should pick up our mail if we have any.
You have one today. They came in from the railroads. It's from Dublin. You'll have to pay for it, though.
How much money do ye have, Willie?
I saved 93 cents in case we had a letter from home.
Well, you're in luck. This letter only cost 72 cents.
Letter's about me, Dad. Now I can't be in the war and I can't work in the railroad, so I can't earn any money. Ugh.
Some would say you're lucky not to be in the war.
I completely agree with them.
Well, some would say not. I could be out in the Irish Brigade earning my honor and toughness, but I'm stuck here with my broken leg. Americans only give us the dirty jobs. Why couldn't I be postmaster?
We are expanding so as the railroad continues to connect our great nation, and I have a job opening for an apprentice.
Really?
Well, that would be great.
You have to be able to read and write, of course.
I taught myself at the farm.
You also have to pass an exam. It's not that hard. Come in tomorrow.
I got a job, Mom.
Yes, you did.
X-ray, X-ray, newspaper. Read it out yourself. News from the battlefield, 12 cents.
I think I'll buy one.
Here you go.
I hope it's good sale.
I'm Ben Parker and I played the part of Willie O'Malley, an Irish boy.
I am Bradley Baker and I played the part of Molly O'Malley, Willie O'Malley's Irish mother.
I'm Serena Govindaya. I played the part of Lysander Spooner, the slave.
I am Natalie J. Menches, and I played the part of a newspaper seller and a poor/regular person.
I'm Colin Race, and I played the part of an angry man named Mr. A.G. Frick.
I'm Allie Randall, and I played the part of Susan Wells, a wretch girl.
I'm Erin Knuth, and I played the part of Sarah Wells, Allie's mother.
I'm Grant Thompson. I played the postmaster, John Armstrong.
Thank you.
year is 1850. We are immigrants and we are at an auction.
I can't believe we made it. Can you, brother?
Yes, brother. We actually made it to America, and here we are in Illinois. How fortunate we are to try our hand at farming this fertile land.
The man we need to find is an immigrant from England. His name is Robert Smith.
Good morning. I am my name. What do you need?
I am Gunther. This is my brother Otto. We have come from Germany by way of New York, where a man told us to find you. We have hopes of farming. We sold our farm in Germany to pay for passage to America and a new start.
Well, it seems you have come at a good time, because I need help. You are hired. When I first came here from Burg St. Peter's, Norfolk, of East Anglia in England, I was discriminated against and couldn't find a job. When I bought my farm, land was, and still is, $1.25 an acre.
You did have a hard time.
Yes, and that's why I'm hiring you. Your pay will be 15 cents per day.
Thanks. Show us where to start.
Wait, we don't have a place to stay. Do you have a spare room?
Yes, my daughter got married and moved on a while ago.
Thank you for the room.
All in a day's work.
Good day, Thomas. Any luck finding a job?
No, I didn't. After I asked for the job and the manager said no, he gave it to an American walking by.
Same here, except after I asked, he closed the shop.
It is discouraging that so many Americans hate the Irish. I wish things were different. We came here thinking it was going to be a better life with lots of jobs and money, but instead we get judged and denied based on our home country.
Do you remember when we came over? Thomas, you were young then.
Yes, I'm only a year younger than you. I got so sick. I hated coming over here. First class was more like death sentence. How is it first class if we were in the worst conditions?
The Americans want to make money off us, charging us for everything, right down to their own tools for our jobs. Things have to get better. I'm going back out to find a job.
Then why are we in jobs? Never mind that for now. Don't get angry if they say no. They might start rumors about you to the other shopkeepers. I've been hearing about the influence of the know-nothings. They're worried that the newcomers will get jobs and power.
Isn't that the political party called the American Party? They're proposing to make it so that immigrants have to live in America for 25 years before becoming citizens, thus delaying our right to vote.
That would be another hardship. Maybe I'll try my hand at making harnesses or saddles. Let me know how you do.
I see you have hired a girl.
Yes, she recently came from Ireland.
Why did you come here?
I came here for a better life. Back in Ireland, many people have been dying of starvation since 1845 as a result of the potato famine. The famine was devastating, and the trip over was grueling as well. We traveled on a cargo ship. There were nearly 900 other passengers on that ship. Many had fatal illnesses. Our meals mainly consisted of rough grain hardened into a big lump. Overall, the conditions were, how do you say it, inhumane.
Well, did you come by yourself?
No, actually. My brother and sister came over with me.
I'm surprised you hired an Irish girl. You know what they say? Are you sure it's a good idea to have her working in your house?
I've hired help for several years now, and quite a few of them have been immigrants.
Well, I would keep an eye on her.
5 years later, the year is 1855, this is how our lives have changed.
I put everything I had into this farm, buying this land for $1.25 an acre. Now I look forward to selling my land and moving to Missouri.
Our work for Robert Smith has allowed us to save money. Land has been selling for $3.75 an acre.
Today we hope to buy his farm. Finally, we will be working for ourselves.
When we left our homeland, we were facing starvation. They estimated over 2.5 million Irish escaped the Irish potato famine by coming to the United States. Perseverance has paid off for me. I am now hired help, able to earn $1.50 each week, and I have learned how to manage a household. Thomas has done well, too.
I was determined to develop my skills making harnesses and saddles. Word got out. Now my customers include many of the finest people in Springfield, Illinois. My life has improved also. The Lincolns consider me as hired help, which means I assist the mistress in maintaining her home. My duties include laundress, lamp cleaner, water carrier, and most importantly, child care provider. That boy over there is the youngest of the Lincoln family. His dad calls him Tad because he's as wiggly as a tadpole.
I was skeptical of the immigrants moving to Springfield, mixing their ways with ours. These people have come from various backgrounds, bringing their determination for a better life. I've had a chance to see them make their lives better and our community stronger.
I too had my doubts. However, I have to agree with Mr. Lincoln. Did you see his letter published in the newspaper recently?
Actually, I did read it. He seems quite disgusted with the New or Know Nothing Party. Their stand on immigration goes against our Declaration of Independence.
Indeed it does. Mr. Lincoln wrote that if the Know Nothings ever took power, then the Declaration of Independence would have to be amended to say that all men are created equal except Negroes, foreigners, and Catholics.
He went so far as to say he would rather emigrate to any other country than live in such an America.
The United States is great because of the sum of the many.
I'm Parker Seaton, and I played the role of Thomas Shepard, an Irish immigrant.
I'm Logan Kuhn, and I played the role of a German immigrant named Gunther.
I'm Gavin Bennett, and I played the role of Otto, a German immigrant and Gunther's brother.
I'm Gwen Gokenauer, and I played the role of Robert Smith, an English immigrant.
I'm Annalisa Bate, and I played the role of Mary Lincoln.
I'm Kirsten Schwer, and I played Mary Lincoln's sister, Elizabeth Todd.
I am Eliza Samaniego, and I played the role of Catherine, an Irish immigrant who worked for the Lincolns.
I am Audrey Langham, and I played Alana, an Irish immigrant, sister of Thomas and Catherine.
Inventors and the awesome things that they invented during the mid-1800s. Wow, there are so many people who invented or improved things that we still use today, such as Josephine Cochran, who innovated the dishwasher, or John S. Mosby, who invented the machine gun. Or I didn't know that ironclad warships were made during that time period, or that spies such as John S. Mosby played such a big role during the Civil War. Wow, even women such as Nurse Clara Barton were able to help out. What in the world? All of the words have faded from the pages. I think I'm going to need professionals to help solve this mystery. Hello, time travel police squad. I think someone's changing history. Can you help?
Time detectives Jason Bobatus and Danny Bobespi at your service. Sounds like we have a 401k in progress.
Sir, don't you mean a C320 time alteration instead?
That's definitely a 401k. Let's get back to the 1800s.
This is Josephine Cochran, sir. She innovated the automatic dishwasher in 1854 and later got a patent for it in 1886. This innovation makes busy moms thankful for dishwashers every day.
Can we help?
Well, I host many dinner parties and would love to have a machine that washes dishes quickly without chipping or breaking any in the process. If nobody else is going to invent a proper dishwashing machine, I'll do it myself. I'm quite certain all my friends would want one too. Let's see. If I had a compartment to fit each dish, then add a copper boiler to heat the water, and add this motor to turn that wheel, and add some soap, then the water would squirt up and rain down all over the dishes. That's it. I think this will work, but someone has drawn all over my blueprint. And it's so hard for women to get patents in these days for working inventions, let alone not working ones.
Look, there's a big handprint on the back of this blueprint.
You know, spying during the Civil War was important to both the North and the South. Spies were able to relay details of troop movements and strengths as well as to disrupt communications between army battalions. Being able to get in and out of a situation without anyone noticing is essential for any spy.
A spy? Next stop, 1861.
Richard Gatling invented the first easily usable and reliable machine gun in 1861. His basic design is still in use today.
My heavens, where did you two come from?
We're here to help.
Well, I could definitely use some help. My name is Richard J. Gatling, and I invented the repeating machine gun. It consists of 6 to 10 rotating gun barrels, each of which has its own firing mechanism. The barrels are turned by a hand crank, with each barrel loading, firing, and ejecting the cartridges from it. At last count, it could fire between 150 to 200 rounds of ammo per minute without overheating. I can't figure out why it keeps exploding. I invented this gun with the hope that it would help reduce the size of armies and be an instrument of peace, but now it won't even work. Balderdash.
All the evidence is pointing to sabotage.
Definitely a spy. Let's talk to Claire Barton at the U.S. Patent Office.
This letter can't be right. I need to leave this job to train as a nurse, but this letter says I can't go now. How strange.
Sir, in 1861, Clara Barton worked in the U.S. Patent Office as a recording clerk. As federal troops came into Washington, D.C., she felt a great need to assist men in uniform with providing supplies and medical care.
Ma'am, how can we help?
Working in the U.S. Patent Office has given me so much useful information about medicine, medical practices, and inventions. These have helped many people be cured of things like cancer and other diseases. An example of a medical invention that helped many people is the Chisholm Anesthesia Inhaler. Dr. Julian John Chisholm invented this portable nasal inhaler to administer chloroform through a sponge. This helped to keep the fumes away from the medical personnel during surgery. I so very much want to help, but this letter says I must stay in the patent office instead.
Ms. Barton, this isn't an authentic letter. You should continue with what you want to do. We're closing in on the culprit. Let's travel to see what we can learn from John Erickson.
John Erickson designed the first ironclad ship, the Monitor, for the Union Army. At the same time, the Confederate Army was refitting the burned Merrimack as an ironclad for the South. The first ironclad to be completed and set into battle was the Confederate Merrimack.
Oh yes, I remember now. In March of 1862, the Merrimack was the first of the Battle of Hampton Roads. It began sinking the wooden ships of the Union Army. The Monitor arrived before too much damage was done and kept the Merrimack from destroying the Union fleet. Erickson's basic design has greatly affected modern sea warfare.
I was granted the contract to construct the iron ships by President Abraham Lincoln himself. These warships were to be outfitted with armor made from iron plates and wedges to help it sit low in the water, thus making it harder to sink. The USS Monitor was going to be a beauty to see, with guns and rotating turrets weighing in at over 927 tons. Imagine seeing an iron giant of a ship equipped with massive guns and cannons in the water blocking your way. But alas, it won't happen now. The pitch of my design is missing.
Sir, if Mr. Erickson doesn't get those plans done, the USS Monitor won't arrive in time to defend the Union fleet from the Confederate Merrimack, which could change history. Hey you, stop right there.
Explain yourself.
I'm Colonel John S. Mosby, the best Civil War spy I know. I have devised a way of fighting in which a small band of my men could harass and defeat a much larger force. Mosby Raiders, as we are famously known, cut telegraph lines, ambush messengers, start fires, arrest all rail transport, and then disappear into the night. I could slip in and out of the enemy lines undetected, all the while sabotaging communication between Union forces. I have even captured one Union general, 30 enlisted men, and 58 horses without firing a single shot. I have been sabotaging inventions to change the future. I would have gotten away with it if you two detectives hadn't been so knowledgeable about inventions during the Civil War time period.
Learning about the past helps us to plan for the future. Thank you for explaining yourself, Colonel Mosby. I think you need to return this to John Erickson, though. It's time to clean up your mess.
Susie Q, we solved the case. A Civil War spy was the culprit behind the missing historical facts.
That's great. I had no idea that Clara Barton invented the dishwasher in Shelbyville, Illinois. That's not too far from here, you know. Or that
or that Richard Gatling lived right next to the author Mark Twain, or that Clara Barton went on to become a nurse and started the American Red Cross. And did you know that John S. Mosby was known as the Great Ghost because of his stealth and quickness?
I hope you were able to gain a wealth of knowledge in your research. As Albert Einstein said, learn from yesterday, live for today, and hope for tomorrow. Case closed.
I am Sarah Sheikha, and I played Clara Barton, the founder of the American Red Cross.
I'm Tori, and I played Josephine Cochran, the innovator of the dishwasher.
I'm Aiden, and I played Danny Bilbesby, the assistant time detective.
I am Mason, and I play Jason Bobatis, the lead time detective.
I'm Quinn, and I played the part of John Erickson, the inventor of the ironclad.
I'm Bennett, and I played the part of Richard Gatling, the inventor of the machine gun.
I'm Aiden, and I played the role of John S. Mosby, the Civil War spy.
I'm Kaylin, and I played Susie Q, the researcher. Sorry.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Please come with me as we travel back in time. The setting is an 1850s town hall meeting where we will discuss the pros and cons of railroads coming into our community. You will hear many different townspeople say their reasons. And now let the meeting commence. So, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Today we'll discuss whether we should or shouldn't build railroads in our fair town. You have all talked about roads a lot, and I want you to tell the audience your opinions. First is Mrs. Johnson.
I'm against the railroads.
Please state your reason.
I say this because they are safety hazards for people and children. One day I was on the train and the railroad track sprung up and almost killed me, my children, and my husband. It was the most terrifying experience for us. My husband is a porter for the United States Railroad when he was almost kidnapped, but got helped by a coworker. Now you may not think this isn't the worst thing to happen to a woman, but actually my children can't live without him. Neither can I. I loved him so much and I wouldn't know if he was dead or alive or getting hit or beat as we speak. This is not how I want to live my life. Who knows, me or my children could be next. Just because we live in the North doesn't mean we're not in danger. How can you make the railroad safe? How's that for a reason? I hope we make the right decision.
Okay, thank you. Next is Mr. Franklin and Mr. Jameson.
I'm Mr. Franklin.
And I'm Mr. Jameson.
And we're the investors in the railroads. The railroads should seriously help transportation.
I disagree completely.
Mrs. Ruth, please be quiet and let them finish. Go on.
This will make traveling faster and stronger.
Yet ladies have to get up so that they can chop wood so that the trains can keep going. Must you bring these road inventions into our community? You must make them even faster and even stronger.
Mrs. Ruth, I told you to be quiet and let them finish. Go on.
This is much safer than using canals and horse wagons during poor weather. I'm pretty sure the West would agree with having an easier way for immigrants to travel to the West to increase the population as any other place.
We have better reasons than any of these citizens here. We will fix every problem in the railroad.
We will build and improve the length of the railroad only if you let us. For example, we will stabilize the rails so they don't pop up and kill our passengers.
This will give thousands of dollars to the economy.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next is Mrs. Freeman.
I am against the railroads.
Please state your reason.
These rentals are extremely inconvenient. I just bought a new dress and I had to get off the train to get one to work. Trains are supposed to be a luxury. This is not helpful to me or my dress whatsoever. Trains also take land. I am currently fined for my house in order not to live on the streets with my children, and I cannot afford to buy a new house, especially with the economy like it is now. I hope you take this into consideration.
Okay, thank you. Next is Mrs. Ruth.
I'm against railroads.
Please state your reason.
I, as a lady and higher member of society, do not intend to go out in the rain in my finery to chop wood. And I really don't want to share the train cars with these disgusting townspeople and farmers. At least in the South, they have the sense to lessen the number of train stations and actual trains that they are taking and building. Must you bring these horrid inventions into our community, still in early stages? If you do, I will surely leave the state.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Ruth. Next is Mrs. Severs.
I am for the railroads.
Please say your reason.
Well, I love the idea of faster transportation because I'm always late in family gatherings when I travel by boat or stagecoach. Also, this is so convenient. I don't have to travel outside and get bugs in my dress because we're inside. I just love it. They're nice luxuries, and I understand that we need to chop wood, or maybe in the future we could ride in relaxation. Also, this will help the economy a great deal. I say this because more people will ride the train, which means more money goes to the economy, so we can have better lives. And if we don't have enough people to build the railroad, we can always get German and Irish immigrants to help lay on the tracks, so the railroad can come to Springfield much easier.
Okay, thank you. Next is Mr. Jackson.
I'm against the railroads.
Please state your reason.
I would like to say that by bringing these railroads to Springfield, you are taking away money from yourself and from the community. The money that you are spending could be used to create a better, more stable town hall. You could also use the money to create more jobs and schools. Even though we already have many choices of transportation, such as horse-drawn wagon, boat, and by foot. And the other day, my sister walked out onto the road and got mud all over her shoes because of how poorly the roads were built. If you just take the time to think about what you're spending your money on, you would see that these railroads are not needed.
Okay, thank you. Since everyone is finished, I'll take all your statements into consideration. You can come back at the end of the week, and I'll tell everyone the decision as to whether we should or shouldn't build railroads in our fair town. If I'm unable to decide, then we'll have to take a vote. I hope you have a wonderful day, and I bid you farewell. Meeting adjourned.
I am Darcy, and I played the part of Miss Ruth.
I'm Lauren, and I play the part of Mrs. Freeman.
I'm Maddie, and I play the part of Miss Severs.
I'm Destiny, and I play the part of Miss Johnson.
I'm Eric, and I play the part of the mayor and the narrator.
I'm Tyson, and I played the part of Mr. Jackson.
I'm Devin, and I played the part of Mr. Jameson.
I'm Gianni, and I play the part of Mr. Franklin.
It's past midnight.
Yes, but we still have many things to sew and pack. The train to Camp Butler leaves at 5:30 this morning.
How are you doing with the Sharpie, June?
Just fine. I've scraped off a little lint, see?
Good job, June. The doctors will use that to soak up the soldiers' blood. Although, I wish I could do more. What if I was a nurse?
Miss Davis, how dare you?
Nursing could be exciting, saving people's lives and making a change.
June, dear, go help Miss Miner pack the rest of the cloth and bandages into the last boxes. The dried meat and fruit have already been packed.
Yes, Mother.
Miss Davis, I'm surprised at you. Such preposterous ideas.
Mrs. Ives, I really do believe it is my job to be more involved in this war. As a nurse, I could do so much more.
You know very well that ladies like you and I never care for men who are not of our relation.
But it doesn't have to be like that. Women in America are gaining more freedom and rights. And besides, think of all the men dying in the mud, wounded, hungry, and infected.
We are representing one of the Ladies' Aid Societies of Illinois. We are upper class, logical, and we are not, never will be nurses in dirty, diseased hospitals.
Can you believe that Miss Davis wants to be a nurse?
Yes, she always says what's on her mind.
Well, you wouldn't want to be a nurse when you grow up, would you?
I think that being a nurse is a great idea, but Mother would never let me.
I agree with your mother. It's inappropriate for women to care for strange men.
What if they need our help?
Enough chatter about this. You are still a child. Let's make sure we have everything we need. Do we have our dry fruit?
Yes.
Do we have our housewives?
What's a housewife?
A housewife is a little tin box of bandages, needles, thread, and yarn.
Oh yes, we have those.
Good. Can you go and tell your mother?
Mother, there's someone at the door.
Oh, who could be at my house at this time of night?
I don't know, Mother, but I'm scared.
Good evening, ma'am. We don't mean no harm.
We just need a place to rest for a few minutes.
Oh, goodness, please take a seat. Miss Miner, June, go fetch Dr. Wallace.
Oh my, look at your bandages. They are filthy and need to be changed.
Miss Miner, June, go fetch Dr. Wallace. Miss Davis, bring some tear soup for these poor soldiers. Now then, where did you men come from?
We were taking a gunboat from Shiloh to St. Louis, then a train to Camp Butler, but I couldn't make it that far because my wound was starting to get infected.
Shiloh!
Kessa here was addled after getting too close to a cannon.
Addled?
You know, confused like. Oh, he's been acting odd ever since. I had to stop him from looking down his musket. We had to take it away from him.
I saw General Parker carrying Kessa out of the bow and I ran to help him. And right as he was telling me to shot in the arm, I felt a bullet go through my leg.
Oh, goodness.
That's right. We stood behind the tree. Williams firing his musket every once in a while. When General Grant found us, he told us to get on the train to Camp Butler. But when my arm started to feel like it was going to fall off, I said that we should get off our train and find the nearest shelter.
So that's where you got your wounds from?
That's correct, and that's why we need a hospital fast.
No hospital! No hospital! Gateway to death!
You, young man, calm down now.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. What's this all the rush in the middle of the night?
Oh, thank you for coming, Dr. Wallace. These three Union soldiers appeared at my front door, injured.
Let's have a look. Oh, what are your boys' names?
General Charles Parker, sir.
Abraham Kessler.
And Jack Williams, sir.
Very nice, and what has happened to all of you men?
Ah, shot in the arm.
Shot in the leg.
Shiloh!
Kessler here was addled after getting too close to the cannon.
I've been addled! I see. Well, let me take a look at that arm again, Parker. It looks infected. We'll need to change your dressing and do the leech procedure.
What's the leech procedure?
It's quite simple. It's when they put leeches on your wound to suck it clear of any infection.
As long as it helps my arm.
I can still hear the cannons!
There, there.
Ladies, I know you're all tired, but we still have many crates to fill and slippers to sew.
June, please go see if your older brother has any leeches.
Yes,
sir. Mr. Williams, I must say, you sew very well for a man.
Oh, why thank you. But Mama taught all of her children to sew. I'm a right good cook too.
So, I was wondering if one of you ladies could help me to a cot.
Alright, doctor.
Do you think there's something strange about Mr. Williams?
Yes, there's definitely something unusual about that man.
I wonder.
What are you discussing, Mother?
Nothing, dear.
Go see if Dr. Wallace and Miss Davis need help.
Mr. Parker, please hold still. It won't hurt that much. Miss Davis is going to wrap your arm.
No, sir. I won't have a woman putting hands on me.
That woman is going to mend your arm while I go check on your friends. Be grateful for her.
I said no. Get away from me. I won't have a woman putting hands on me.
General Parker, it'll only take a moment.
I said no.
You goober. I've been helping you this whole time, and I'm a woman, and you didn't put up no fight when I dragged you to the mud of Shiloh.
So that's why you sew so well.
Now you know. I disguised myself as a man to fight side by side with my husband. He got shot right in front of my eyes. I never saw anything so shocking. Oh yeah, I was crying, of course. But I had to continue to find this worse. I stepped over him and went on with my life.
Woman!
This is a disgrace to the Union. Only men should be able to fight in the field of battle. A woman's place is in the home.
Women can do anything they put their minds up to do. I bet one day, women will even be able to vote.
That'll be the day.
Stop bickering. There's still much work to be done.
I just don't know where I go now. No husband, no regiment.
Well, I guess you could stay here for now. We need all the help we can get. And it appears our dear Miss Davis may leave us to become a nurse.
Yeah, yes.
The more the merrier, Mr. Williams.
Francis Clayton.
Now, Mr. Parker, you just rest here tonight. I'll take you to the hospital at Camp Butler tomorrow morning. It's not far.
No hospital! No hospital!
Now, Mr. Kessler, I'll go with you. I'll take care of you. You're going to be just fine.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you all so much. This is going to show you don't have to be a soldier to have honor during wartime. Everyone has an important role. Well, thank you all for coming to see your Soldiers Aid Society play. My name is Helena Moore, and I played the part of Jack Williams and Francis Clayton.
I'm Willa Daniels, and I played the part of Elizabeth Ives.
I'm Casey Douglas, and I played the part of Abraham Kessler.
I'm Isaiah Hansen, and I played the part of General Charles Parker.
I'm Fatina Faisal, and I played the part of Piper Davis.
I'm Summer Williams, and I played the part of Miss Minor.
I'm Josie Robson, and I played the part of June Ives.
I'm Aiden Lane, and I played the part of Dr. William Wallace.
Mr. Lincoln, and early today, are we?
Oh, yes. Her and I have been to a swamp again. The case is finished.
Well, if anyone's equipped to handle that kind of workload, it's you.
I appreciate your kind words, Mr. Tinsley. It's good to hear. How's business?
Business is booming. Really, don't move down here. I'm surprised you can't hear the commotion. There's only four above us.
Her and I have been so concerned to get these cases finished. We haven't really heard much. It's good to hear your business is doing well. You have a fine shot set up.
Thank you, sir. Have you had any interesting cases lately?
Just about every case with the state Supreme Court is an interesting new challenge.
Wow, that starts with a lot of work.
It is a lot of work, but it is worth it. I think I'm almost ready for a new challenge. Maybe someday I'll run for president.
Wouldn't that be something? Mr. Lincoln, president.
I guess we'll have to wait and see. But first I have to reach the Senate.
Oh, almost forgot. Your writ is due tomorrow.
I'll be sure to bring it in.
I appreciate it.
It's good to talk to you, Mr. Tinsley, but I must get to work.
Very well, sir.
Goodbye.
President, yeah, right.
How old are you now?
If Mrs. Lincoln were here, these mama boys would be much better behaved.
How old are you now, young man?
I am 7 years old.
Well, isn't that just adorable?
Someday, Calvin and I are going to fight in the army, just like my daddy did in the Black Hawk War. Me and my daddy have been practicing my wrestling every night until my mama breaks us up.
Hey, Robert, do you want to play kick the can?
Of course.
You boys need to grow up.
This might be my last day to play for a while. Now that the growing season is here, and my family need me on the farm to carry water and gather our fruits and vegetables.
Then what are we waiting for? Let's get started.
You boys need to buy something or get out. How'd you get your father to hurt, Robert?
Oh no, anything but my father. You sound just like Mr. Herndon. Hey Calvin, I could go with some candy. What about you?
Yeah, sounds good to me.
There's candy on that shelf.
Gonna head upstairs?
We'll take five pieces, please. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Can you believe that, Lincoln boy, Catherine? He's like a wild dog.
I know, Eliza. It's a shock that father lets them run around town like that.
I heard he doesn't discipline them at all.
I can't believe they're having another one soon.
I agree. The last thing Springfield needs is another Lincoln boy. Speaking of the Lincolns,
it seems as if Mrs. Lincoln is too good to do her own shopping.
I wonder what she needs now. She's more dressed than anyone in Springfield.
Speaking of dresses, what are you wearing to Mrs. Lincoln's strawberry party next week?
Oh, I will have my servant make me a dress for the party. That reminds me, I have to be picking out some satin calico for Mr. Tinsley later on today.
I'll be buying my dress. I don't have time to make my own with scheduling my wedding with Samuel.
Miss Lincoln is hosting the Edwards tonight. As you know, Miss Lincoln likes to bake Mr. Lincoln's favorite dessert, apple bread pudding. I'm looking for your finest apples.
Well, today's your lucky day. Mr. Tinsley shouldn't have apples just arrived with me.
One of a kind, Mary. How was your trip?
Same 15 miles it's always been. Not much new on the country. I'd love a little bit of company, but Paul and my sons are out there working so hard on that land.
At least you arrived safely and business seems to be stable. Are your rates the same as last time or something else that suits you?
We are still on for $2 a pound, and I brought with me 7 pounds. However, I would really enjoy some new cotton linen. All my other bonnets, aprons, and dresses are falling apart. My son's birthday is next week, and I need some wool to make him a new pair of dress trousers.
Well, if that's the case, I'll be likely to trade those materials for the best apple in the Springfield area.
Mr. Tinsley, you have yourself a deal.
Excellent. I'll show all the boys around to get them.
I'll meet them there.
May I please purchase 8 of those apples?
Of course. Is there anything else?
Miss Lincoln would like to know if you have any remedies for stomach pain.
What is wrong with Mrs. Lincoln?
Miss Lincoln is in the family way, as you may already know. Her stomach has been troubling her in the morning.
I think I heard that before. Here, just a thing. Tell her to take this before bed in the morning.
Thank you. How much do I owe you?
That'll be $4 total.
Goodbye, Mr. Tinsley.
Hello, Mr. Tinsley. It's a beautiful day, isn't it?
Sure it is.
Well, anyway, I would like to buy this fabric for a new dress of mine. Do you have some extra calico?
No, I don't have any extras. It'll be $1 for the whole bundle.
But Mr. Tinsley, I thought it was only 90 cents.
But what matters to you, Willard? Your husband's one of the richest men in Springfield. I mean, he's the mayor all. The buyer will be on your way.
How rude. My husband will be hearing about this. Have you noticed Mr. Tinsley has been very cross these past few weeks? We must be having problems with Hannah Taylor again.
Isn't that his wife? I didn't know they were still married. I thought they got divorced the last time they had problems.
I don't recall them ever separating, but how do their children do with all the fighting and yelling at home?
If I was one of the children, I wouldn't be able to handle the noise.
Mr. Tinsley's neighbor, you know the one that works for my husband?
Are you talking about Mr. Cray?
Yes, he often comes in rants about how you can always hear them fighting at night.
Let's just visit Hannah and see how she's doing with Mr. Tinsley.
I've already finished my shopping and work. We can go right now, nothing else to do.
Thank God, that's over.
How'd it go today, Mr. Tinsley?
Long day, to say the least.
I agree. Better luck tomorrow.
Hopefully. Have a good day, Mr. Lincoln.
Goodbye, Mr. Tinsley. See you tomorrow.
Friday early.
I'm Mary, and I played Mary Burgess, a farmer's wife.
I'm Lisa, and I played Bridget Murphy, a Mary Todd's servant.
I'm Lexi, and I played Catherine, a rich society woman.
My name is Macy, and I played Eliza, a rich society woman.
My name is Justin. I played Mr. Tinsley, a store owner.
My name is Jason. I played Calvin, a kid.
My name's Ethan. I played Robert Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln's oldest son.
My name is Sean. I play Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln? Ooh.